The Small Business Survival Group is made up of small storekeepers from both the Newcastle and Lake Macquarie Council areas. The storekeepers decided to form the collective because as individuals they felt unable to fight for what they consider to be their rights. They claim that as more and more service stations expand to include grocery outlets, their livelihoods are being threatened. And according to the group spokesman, Mr. Keith Jansen, time is running out.
There can only be a certain number of people to purchase things, and if we have a greater number of places supplying them, naturally it must dramatically affect each one's income.
Why do you think these supermarkets are opening up in the service stations?
Well, it's obviously backed by oil companies here at this point, because it's the oil companies that's completely rebuilding these buildings, and we feel that that they get their corner is sufficient at the moment without entering into the grocery side of it.
About 30 people are taking part in the seminar organised by the Department of Technical and Further Education and the Combined Unions Unemployed Group. All those participating are redundant workers from the steel, meat and building industries. The seminar, however, is not aimed at helping those people find jobs. It is looking at numerous job creation schemes which could potentially help many of the region's unemployed. Mr. Max Ogden, the educational officer with the Metal Workers Union in Victoria, has been brought to Newcastle to conduct the seminar. He believes that increased worker participation is the answer, at least in part, to the problem of redundancy.
The best way overall is to develop a fiscal and budgetary policy that is much more expansionary than it currently is, and is looks to be proposed in the budget. However, along with that, we want to see things like programs of alternative work, as we've done in the aircraft industry in Victoria. Which
our society is largely based on the idea that people in important positions make the decisions, and a lot of people accept that, including not only the people in the high positions, but people who are ordinary workers and so on often accept that as well. What we're trying to get through to people on the workshop floor or in offices or wherever, that they've got to get in and make some decisions and insist that some notice be taken of them, when necessary, impose decisions.
Three groups have combined to push for a Newcastle taxation office. They are the Hunter Development Board, the Chamber of Commerce and the Newcastle City Council. Together they have surveyed more than 3,500 taxation employees in Sydney, and they were asked if they would live in Newcastle. The results? 336, definitely yes. 342, maybe. That's a total of 678 people who could be considered. Among them, highly skilled employees, which is what we need to ensure the establishment of a local office. According to those involved in the proposal, Newcastle has satisfied all the requirements of the Commissioner of Taxation. We have the space for a large office, and now we have the expertise. But what we don't have is the Commissioner's reply.
The final decision obviously is in the hands of the Commissioner and the Government. The information has only become available today, so we've now sent it to those two parties.
If he doesn't act soon, there could be the chance that these figures will change.
We believe that at the very moment with the rail strike on, we think the number of people wanting to move to Newcastle will increase anyway. You're right, there is a need though to act on them, and we are looking for an immediate response.
Meanwhile, you're doing a follow-up survey.
We are. We indicated to the people when we made the presentations that we would come back and give them detailed information on further aspects and questions they may have.
well.
It was definitely a time for boasting. Lingard Hospital at Merriweather had passed the council's rigid new set of standards with flying colours. Accreditation is a voluntary process where surveyors from the council assess facilities and make recommendations for improvements. And Lingard received the fewest criticisms ever achieved by an Australian hospital.
The patients and the doctors, the community of Newcastle, they can now be assured that Lingard has reached a standard equal to the best set for hospitals in Australia, whether it be public or private hospital.
The hospital was praised for its food, which is a rarity in itself, and was also commended on the standard of patient care. But the hospital staff had to put in a concerted effort to meet with the Australian Council of Hospital Standards regulations.
We had to train every staff member in the hospital on the various fire procedures. This included the ability to evacuate patients, to know how to fight a fire, all this type of thing. There were others as well. We had to, of course, improve our control on infections, this type of thing. The total range of quality care of patients had to be improved.
Do you think your accreditation will put pressure on other hospitals in the region to up their standards?
I think that's inevitable.
At the moment, the Newcastle Treatment and Training Unit of the Spastic Centre is in Carrington. This new 2.5 hectare site off Tingara Drive, Crowders Bay, will become the new school for 19 pupils. However, there was to be more built on this site, a nursing home and a sheltered workshop. Without these two other facilities, the Spastic Centre no longer qualifies for financial assistance. And now there's some doubt about the future of the school.
We had been promised a nursing home. Deficit funding through the Health Commission had been approved. And with the nursing home now not being allowed to be built on our land as a complex along with the school, any therapy areas which we have and are absolutely necessary in the running of the school, like occupational therapy, physio, speech pathology, the deficit funding there could have been incorporated with the nursing home. Also the buses, if you've got a nursing home, are classed as ambulances, which gives us a cheaper rate of running, registration, whatever, and makes the running of the school, including those facilities, much more expensive and harder to maintain.
Are you against the principles of the Richmond Report?
No, not against...
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. We're, of course, talking about lump sum superannuation payments. And I strongly believe, notwithstanding what the government has proposed, that they will be forced to back down in one way, shape or form. My gut tells me, and forgive the expression, that they will introduce a tax-free threshold. Now, I can't be sure what that threshold will be, but if I were asked to guess, I would suggest probably $50,000, and in my view, rightly so. Now, it's all very well for the federal government, with notwithstanding the best of intentions, to say that they want to change the superannuation benefits from lump sums to, shall we say, ordinary pensions. But that's going to take a long time. And just please tell me, what is the benefit to elderly people of having income by way of ordinary pension or an annuity if, for example, they need money to paint their house or go for a trip overseas? That income might be there, but many, many people need the benefits of lump sums in one way, shape or form. Now, that's my view, and I'm sure it's the view of thousands, if not tens of thousands, indeed hundreds of thousands of people who do belong to superannuation schemes. Now, you may have already complained to your local Member of Parliament about the proposed changes. If you haven't, well then I'm suggesting that's what you do. And if you've already complained, I would go back and complain again, because I don't think the government really appreciates how negative this proposal is, or these proposals are. I think it will do the wrong thing. I'm just trying to think of the right word to express my feelings. I think it will do the wrong thing as far as future investors are concerned. And when I say investors, I'm talking about people who are providing for their own superannuation needs. I'll be back with you next Monday.
About 200 men, members of the Newcastle Retail Fruit and Vegetable Merchants Association, met this morning. They're protesting and public buying at the markets. They say it threatens their livelihood.
The regional produce markets are owned by the Newcastle City Council, and under council ordinance, they must be open to the public. At this stage, they're open every Friday after 10 o'clock. That's the problem, say the retailers, because the merchants clear on a Friday at prices much cheaper than they buy on the Thursday.
Police were called in to break up the blockade of trucks to allow access to industries in Rural Drive, but access is still blocked to the market. The latest indication is that the retailers have banned purchasing produce through the Newcastle market. This means that supplies may now run low. They've called for an immediate meeting with the town clerk to discuss the dispute.
One treasurer to another, Mr. Ken Booth, member for Walls End, presented the cheque to the treasurer of the Newcastle Young People's Refuge, Mr. Rodney Wilson. It's the lifeblood for the refuge, until the state budget is brought down in September. Coordinator of the refuge, Ms. Olive Spears, says the refuge provides a temporary situation home for at least 200 young people each year. Up to 10 guests can use the refuge facilities at one time, but their stays are restricted to a maximum of 8 weeks. Ms. Spears says it gives the young people some breathing space.
Or if they're under 16.
We provide short-term accommodation for young people who, at a particular point in time, have no other alternative. And included in that is a living skills program, assistance for the young people to sort out their problems, and food, shelter, a safe environment.
Trucks line Rural Drive Sandgate, blocking traffic to the entrance to the markets this morning. About 200 men, members of the Newcastle Retail Fruit and Vegetable Merchants Association, met to discuss the sale of produce to the public at wholesale prices. They say this practice is threatening their livelihood. The regional produce markets are owned by the Newcastle City Council, and under council ordinance, they must be open to the public. At this stage, they're open every Friday after 10 o'clock. That's the problem, say the retailers, because the merchants clear on a Friday at prices much cheaper than they buy on the Thursday.
As the ordinance stands now, the public should be served only after 10 o'clock on Friday. They are served every day of the week in this market. We've identified the public, we've pointed them out to salesmen.
The men decided to stop the movement of produce out of the markets for the day. The police were called in to make sure that other industries in Sandgate had clear access. One member of the public was caught up in the middle of the dispute.
They won't want to get in bloody front of me, mate. They won't want to get in front of me because I won't stop.
There is a sign as you drive in this market that says, that sets out the market times and local government ordinances, and there's a $100 fine. I think it's $100 on the sign, $100 fine for buying outside of set times. And if that's the case that you've bought today, you're subject to a $100 fine.
Yeah, who's going to fine me?
We will prosecute you. The Retail Merchants Association in Newcastle will prosecute you or force the prosecution through if you've bought today.
The retailers won out and the man turned back and left without his load of fruit and vegetables. Late this afternoon, the town clerk Barry Lewis met with the retailers and the Chamber of Fruit and Vegetable Industries. A further meeting has been arranged for this Wednesday with the council. There'll be normal trading at the markets tomorrow.
The northbound meat truck clipped a mobile crane while driving over Stockton Bridge. Police say the accident happened about an hour ago. No one was seriously hurt in the accident, but the driver of the truck was taken to Royal Newcastle Hospital with cuts to his arm. Meanwhile, carcasses are being cleared off the road and the southbound lane has been reopened to traffic.
With the news that as a possible trip to England for the winners of this year's University Shield, schoolboy football has really hotted up. Here in Newcastle, Lambton High shortly going against Chatham of Taree to find out who goes into a semi-final. While on the Central Coast, local heroes, Umina, going against the Cogra side and the favourites, James Cook. That match is played tomorrow at Woi Woi at 12:30. The only guide Umina have against their opponents, James Cook, is the fact that they came seventh in a Tamworth Carnival earlier in the year, while James Cook turned out to be runners-up. Tackling will certainly be a key to the smaller Umina side's chances in this match. Umina on their way to this match beat Crowsnest 40-6, Galston 42-8, Gosford 26-10, and won the inter-regional final against Woi Woi, their near neighbours, but a team in a different category in the state. They beat Woi Woi 14-6. The coach of the side is Wayne Eames, and he's proud of the boys. Number one is Matthew Bull, he's an 18-year-old representative player. One of the wingers, Phil Simons, is a sprint champion locally, while the other winger, Graham Bennett, is already under offer from Newtown and North Sydney. The Palmer brothers wear 4-6. The older one, Gary, is under offer from Newtown, North Sydney and Canterbury. And 15-year-old Lee Palmer is also being chased by the Newtown club. The lock forward, Kevin Clark, is the side's captain, while second row forward, Tony Ross, is a 15-year-old rep from the North Sydney area. Michael Moore, the front rower, is 15 only, but is regarded by his coach as really an outstanding prospect, as is hooker Bruce Mills, a Central Coast representative ball-playing number 12. And Peter McVean is also a very good front row forward. Well, the Umina boys go in against James Cook High, the favourites for the University Shield at Woi Woi tomorrow. They've pulled in big crowds. I reckon tomorrow's crowd at Woi Woi is going to be a bumper.